And welcome to Crash Course Cryptozoology. As I've mentioned previously in several of my videos, I personally am somewhat of an advocate, you could say, for the idea that Sasquatch as a species, if it exists, has many behavioral similarities with known great apes. The one I've talked about likely to the highest extent is facial expressions. Although in other videos, like in my podcasts, I've mentioned and talked about rock throwing, stomping, wood knocking, etc. And today we're going to revisit that topic, but take it from a new angle. New for this channel, anyway. And that angle is going to be vocalizations. The idea for this video originally started as the idea to compile all of the most credible Sasquatch audio, or at least possible Sasquatch audio, into one video so that people could just give it a listen and really analyze it. I realized, however, that if we're going to measure by credibility, there are countless credible people who claim to have Sasquatch audio, and I realized that the video will take much longer than I initially planned. I'll still likely do it at some point, but when it will come, I don't know. While I was looking through audio, I came upon probably the second or first most famous piece of alleged Sasquatch audio. It is also the most scrutinized, which is obviously good for the field. I'm sure a lot of you are very familiar with the Sierra sounds. If you're not, I'll give you a brief summary of what exactly the Sierra sound recordings are. The Sierra sounds were audio pieces recorded in 1971 in the Sierra Nevada mountain region, somewhere between the actual Sierra Nevada mountains and Yosemite National Park, according to the recorders. The recorders themselves are Ron Moorhead and Alan Berry, both of who were hunters and were friends. The story starts when Ron hears of a friend of a friend, I believe, who was 2 days late returning from a hunting trip with his friends. Upon returning, the friend told Ron that they had encountered something very odd in the forest, and what they had encountered, they never quite saw, but they were terrified by it due to the sounds that it made, which were nothing short of monstrous, maybe is the right way to describe it. Being extremely interested, Ron Moorhead took his friend Alan Berry with him up into the Sierra Nevada Mountains in 1971 and camped out there with their audio recorders. According to the two men, what they encountered there is something that convinced both of them that, at the very least, something is out there. The recordings are very well known, and I will play them in this video. They got their strange audio, and they came back, and they had it analyzed by tons of places, really. Tons of people really wanted to figure out what was going on in this recording. We're going to talk about that analysis as well in this video, because there's a lot of misinformation flying around about this recording. Doesn't mean that it's not significant, and I've got my own ideas that I'd like to present in this, but there definitely are misconceptions that need to be addressed. That is basically the story of the Sierra sounds in a nutshell, in a very, very basic nutshell. Before I play it, I'd like all of you to understand that there are pieces in which the men are talking or trying to send back vocalizations in order to try to strike up some kind of strange communication or at least coax more vocalizations out of the animals. According to the men, whenever they did pop out of their tent, the creatures would stop vocalizing, and when they went back in, they would go again. That will become important later on in this video, but for now, here are the Sierra sounds.
In for a night view.
Yeah.
That's right, you.
Across the creek at the big rocks. It's a hard act to follow.
They sound like he talks to us and they talk to each other.
Yeah. Right there, I just seen movement right through there.
I'm not going to do it.
I had considered putting a warning before the Sierra sounds because they are honestly quite disturbing. They're not an easy thing to listen to. Not at all. It's, like I said before, it's absolutely monstrous sounding. What's interesting to me, though, is it also sounds very ape-like, and there are experts who would certainly agree. Most notably, the University of Wyoming investigated these sounds. Their basic conclusions were that the sounds were made by a primate of some kind, that there were likely two or more subjects making vocalizations, and that's not counting the human ones, and that these subjects were likely of different sizes, which can be figured by looking at the vocal range of each subject, which can indicate height and even size of animals. That is most of what people are talking about with the Sierra sounds, is that there are vocal ranges that are being achieved in the Sierra sounds that can't be achieved in human voices. If you want to go check out Thinker Thunker's video on the Sierra sounds, which I highly recommend, he makes a lot of very good points and really sums up what I'm trying to say in this sentence pretty well. Despite the fact that that's flying around, and that is a true point, the rest of the points are often very misconstrued, and even that one is sometimes exaggerated. Before I talk about my own analysis of the Sierra sounds, I would like to address the misconceptions flying around about them. What we know is that a primate made them, we don't know what primate made them, and that if this is somehow a human voice, these are some of the most incredible people on the planet, vocally speaking. So it's not likely that they're humans. However, it is not impossible that they're humans. That is definitely one thing people have been throwing out there saying that it's impossible. It isn't. There is a paper, a scientific paper that I will link in the description that you can go read, that really talks about this, and I am talking about really in-depth analysis, talking about the level of hertz that are present in the recording, the time between each vowel sound. It's really incredible. Basically speaking, it's not likely a human made them, but it's not out of the question that a human made them. What is out of the question, it would seem, for the most part anyway, is digital editing. Again, you'll hear a lot of people saying that there's no way this could have been created digitally. That isn't true either. It's not out of the question that this was digitally created. Given the time that this was recorded, and given the fact that the audio recordings itself don't show many signs of that, it's unlikely, but not impossible. Finally, and this is the one that I'd like to address the most in depth, there are people who really back up the idea that there is not just vocalizations in this recording, there's a set language that you can hear.
What Scott Nelson hears in his headphones is strange, disturbing, and unexplainable all at once.
You're convinced Bigfoot exists?
Yes. I've heard him speak. And you will hear him speak here in a moment.
Before you pass judgment on Nelson, let me tell you a little of his past. He retired from the Navy after a 17-year career as a cryptolinguist, intercepting Russian communications and decoding them. Currently, Nelson is a professor at Wentworth College in Missouri.
Because of what I did in the Navy, you know, spending years and several thousand hours speeding the human voice up and slowing it down, and I detected language in those vocalizations.
Those vocalizations were captured on audio tape in the Sierra Nevada mountains by a group of hunters in the early 70s.
Right here is a juvenile.
Nelson came across them a few years ago while helping his son write a paper on Bigfoot.
I said, "Stevie, there's language here." And he said, "Dad, how can that be? It sounds like a bunch of apes fighting to me." And I said, "Well, we have to slow it down like Dad used to do in the Navy."
Right.
But,
listen for yourself.
I'm just going to let it roll.
Nelson says he instantly knew three things about the sounds he was hearing. One, that he was hearing a language. Two, that it was not human. And three, that it was not fake. It was at that point that he became a Bigfoot believer and researcher.
The number of reports have increased. I think it's becoming more and more accepted for people to come out and say, hey, I had this strange experience. It terrified me, and I need to talk about it.
What is that?
In fact, Bigfoot has never been bigger.
This idea was mainly put out by Scott Nelson, who has a lot of really good credentials, especially in speech. He's got over 35 years studying cryptolinguistics, and he's fluent in four languages. Throughout the recording, what Nelson mainly pointed to was these things called phonemes, which are defined as sounds that, quote-unquote, distinguish one word from another in any particular language. Literally speaking, there are some sounds that in the English language that someone who's been raised on merely, let's say, the Chinese language cannot voice at past a certain age. So they are very biologically linked. And it is interesting that there are phoneme-like sounds detected in the footage. It blew open, you know, the absolute floodgates, really, because this was the first real proof, or evidence, I should say, that if Sasquatch exists, they're intelligent enough to use their own language. Not just sounds that mean certain things, because that's not all that language is. Language is much more coordinated and organized than that. This was a big thing. A very big thing. There's an issue with it, though. Subsequent studies, and studies that were conducted during the same amount of time, or I should say a span of time, suggest that there's no set language or speech happening in the audio. Specifically speaking, the University of Wyoming, one of the studies of the audio of the Sierra sounds was conducted to see if this was somehow a human voice played backwards or something along those lines. So what they looked for, basically speaking, was, okay, well, we do seem to have some repeated sounds. Do these sounds still match up with each other if we put them in reverse? There's a bit more to that, but that's about the gist of it. And when examined, the evidence yielded said, no, when you play it backwards, this does not sound like this is a set language of any kind. Again, language being a very coordinated thing. There is a difference between sounds that mean things and language. What we're looking for is language. And most studies conducted, aside from Scott Nelson's, would suggest that there is no set language in the Sierra sound recording. That is the biggest misconception that I think is very, very important to address. Because when we're talking about a new species, and we have possible evidence that this species can talk, granted, we're the only animal that can talk on the planet. And again, I mean language. When we're talking about a spoken language, we are the only animals that can do it. And to suggest that there is another species out there that can carry that out, that's a huge paradigm. That is a huge thing to claim. And we really need evidence to back that up before we jump on the bandwagon for it. And it seems like a lot of people jumped on the bandwagon without realizing that, despite the fact that there was a professional who believes that there's language in it, other professional studies, multiple ones, suggest that there is no set language. Getting that out of the way, I do want to discuss my own ideas on the Sierra sounds and specific points in them. When I myself first heard the Sierra sounds, and keep in mind, I'm a bit biased, and I'm also not a professional. This is my own thoughts on this. I immediately thought, this sounds like two apes really going at it with each other. One is super angry at the other, and the other one's really not wanting to get punished in some way. I'm not claiming that I think the Sierra sounds are real. I'm saying, hypothetically speaking, if this is an ape on recording, that sounds like what's going on. And the reason I believe that is because looking to the animal kingdom has really yielded a lot of similarities to the Sierra sounds. Mainly in gorillas, for a matter of fact. If you look to gorilla vocalizations, you'll find a lot of somewhat similar-seeming vocalizations. You've got gorillas roaring, you've got gorillas growling, that sound a bit familiar, but nothing too spot on. That is until you realize that maybe it's not specifically copied language or vocalizations that you're looking for. What you're looking for more so is the context behind these vocalizations. This video, in specific, really got me thinking. This is a simple video about a baby gorilla who is really annoying his silverback gorilla father. And the father, being the alpha male, really isn't having it. He gives his son a bit of a bite on the neck, and, you know, the son's not really having that either. He seems like he's crying to some extent. He goes with what I think is the mother, or maybe an older family member. But of course, being the alpha male, the gorilla is not going to go soft on it. What's the context behind that encounter, for starters? Well, the context is a few things. There's the silverback. He's the alpha male. He's not really supposed to be taking that from other gorillas. And so what does he do? He disciplines. But there's something deeper to it than that, too. Primates, and especially humans, are very social animals. Very social animals. When you're the leader of a group raising a child, they can't be successful socially if they're annoying and no one wants to interact with them. The context behind disciplining the baby gorilla is something a bit like, you're not going to amount to anything if you act like this, so I'm going to discipline you so that you don't act like this. It's something like that, which I think is very interesting. I'm going to play the video, and you can just hear these sounds for yourself and tell me if they sound familiar. If you're thinking what I'm thinking, you didn't hear exact copies of vocalizations, but you heard something very similar to this segment from the Sierra sounds. The comparison of these two audio tracks really is what solidifies for me that if this is a real animal, this is an animal, a larger one, disciplining a smaller one, for whatever it might be. The whistling segment of Sierra sounds, in which the men are whistling towards whatever is making these sounds, something whistles back. But then, you've got the larger individual once more, and again, I'm saying larger individual based on the hypothetical measurements of the vocal cords, who is not willing to reciprocate the whistle. And it seems like it really isn't liking that the other one is responding. A lot of these segments really show that there are probably two individuals here. There's a lighter voice and a deeper voice. Deeper voice is probably the larger one. Lighter voice is probably the smaller one. And the one who always seems to get the bigger one going is the smaller one. It's simple, hey, don't do that. Does it anyway. What did I just say? Don't do that sort of thing. What really kills the hypothesis that there is language in this video is a single video that I came across quite recently. The video was on a news station, and it is called Researcher Says Monkey Chatter Sounds Like Human Speech. Again, I'll be linking all these videos in the description as well, so you can look them up and watch them to their utter full extent. Now, unfortunately, the news anchors on this, who I think belong to CNN, they don't really take this seriously. They make a joke out of it, which is unfortunate because the multiple studies that have been done on this segment definitely suggest that, yes, this sounds like human speech. The problem, though, is that when these people hear that, they think, oh, well, we're going to hear the monkey saying words. Well, that's not really, again, that's not entirely what language is. Language is far deeper than just words. Language is context. Language is repeated sounds that have context. Language is the coordination of these sounds. Now, this is not me saying that these monkeys are actually speaking. That's actually what researchers mean by how incredible this is. They're not speaking with each other, but it really, really sounds like they are. And I'll play the video right now and you can hear for yourself.
We are, as you know, big fans of animals at the show, so we were excited by the prospect of a monkey that talked like a human. I mean, that would be amazing, right? Now, when we clicked the video, it didn't quite live up to our expectations, but let's see if it does yours. Okay, that's right. It was just a couple monkeys screeching at each other. Not exactly the human speech we were promised. I mean, when you think of human speech...
So you've got repeated sounds that really do sound like a voice. And not only do you have repeated sounds, you've got replies that are also repeated. Which, isn't language, but it sure sounds a hell of a lot like language. Vocalizations can sound like language without having to be language. It's entirely true that great apes, and even these aren't even great apes, they're monkeys. But both monkeys and great apes are capable of mimicking, intentionally or otherwise, language. For instance, these monkeys that were on the news channel, they are not trying to mimic language. They are simply making sounds that have some sort of context that sound as though they are language. Meanwhile, you have things like this clip of a chimp that perfectly mimics certain human words.
Can you say mama?
Mama.
Mama?
Mama.
Is this for mama?
Mama.
You love your mama?
Mama.
You love mama?
Mama.
Here, sweetie.
But the chimp isn't speaking a language because the chimp only knows, if I make this sound, I will get food. It is not attempting to communicate. Nor is this orangutan, who can only really mimic the word ha or hi.
Very good. Ha.
Hi.
Very good. Ha.
Ha.
Good.
Again, that is not to downplay great apes' sophisticated nature. They are very, very intelligent animals, the most intelligent aside from us. But they're not using language. That's the border. Something can sound like language without being language. Going off of what we see in the animal kingdom and also the studies that have been done, it seems like the Sierra sounds are just that. Vocalizations from something that sound like language, but it probably isn't language. It is probably two individuals, one larger than the other, who may not be human, but also may be human. These two, there's probably one that's too curious and one that's telling it not to get any closer. This is backed up by contextual evidence from Ron and Alan, who said that whenever they left the tent, the vocalizations would cease, and when they went back in, they would continue. The one sounds like it's getting way too curious, and the other one's just trying to keep the status quo. And again, that's if these are Sasquatches. If not, well, we have a pretty sophisticated hoax on our hands. But even with all the misconceptions flying around that I hope all of you have learned something from, I don't find it likely, even especially considering that Alan died in 2012 without ever admitting that this was a hoax, that this was something Ron and Alan cooked up. Unfortunately, to end this off, we have to talk about the fact that the site of the Sierra Sounds was recently burned in the California wildfires and won't be accessible for researchers for some years. It's very fortunate that they were able to get these amazing vocalizations for people to study, for everyone to study, before that occurred. I hope all of you walk away from this video with a better idea of the analysis of the Sierra Sounds, because people are really trying to push narratives, I feel, instead of actually looking at evidence. And instead of bringing ideas forth, they're just trying to push things unquestionably. I think ideas should be questioned, especially with pieces of evidence that are this significant. Let me know what you all think about the Sierra Sounds in the comments below. I hope you enjoyed the video. That being said, until next time.